In this video, you're going to learn how to master the built-in help system in Linux called man. Almost every Linux command, program, and utility has supporting documentation called a man page, which is short for manual page. By the time you finish watching this video, you'll be able to decipher and understand almost anything you see in a man page, and more importantly, be able to put it to use. Let's start at the beginning with actually reading the man page for the man command itself. The format of the man command is man followed by the command you want the man page for. So I'm going to type in man and then man again. I don't want you to get stuck in a man page, so the very first thing to know is that you can simply type the letter Q to quit. So just remember Q to quit, and I'm going to do that now. I'm going to type Q. And now we're back at our prompt. So let's get back into the man page. Another simple but very helpful command to know is H, which stands for help. Here's what happens when you type H. If you ever forget what you're about to learn here, no worries. If you can just remember H for help, you're going to be fine. Just so you know, we're about to spend the next few minutes going over some very tedious details. These are things you have to learn if you want to master this once and for all. It's going to take a few minutes, but it's well worth it. With that little disclaimer out of the way, let's start looking at some commands. The first command that you already know is H to display this help page. By the way, you can type lowercase h or capital H to get here. Also, you'll see that there are five commands that perform the exit action. Typing lowercase q to quit makes the most sense to me, so that's personally what I do, but just know that any of the commands on the left-hand side of your screen perform the action on the right side. I want to point out that man uses the less pager. If you read the header of this help page, it actually says summary of less commands. You can use the less command directly to view and navigate through text files. Likewise, man invokes the less command for you so you can browse through a man page. The less pager is pretty accommodating and it gives you a few different ways to move around. You could probably use your instincts and get by, but I want you to be proficient and really know what you're doing. That's why I'm going to teach you the VI and Vim editor key bindings that less supports. So if you happen to know Vim, this will be super easy for you. And if you don't know Vim, well, this will give you a head start if you ever decide to learn Vim. I personally love and recommend Vim, and I even have an entire course on it called the Vim Masterclass, by the way. So if we take a look at the action of forward one line, you see five different commands that perform that one action. Like I just said, I'm going to teach you the Vim key bindings, so type J to move down one line. So I'll just type J. You can see that the blank line at the top of the screen disappears, and now the first line reads summary of less commands. And when I type J again, that's going to scroll off the top of the screen, and we're going to see another line appear at the bottom. So I type J, and it just keeps moving down like that. So J goes down. Now, if we want to reverse our direction and go up, we can use the K command. So we'll just type K, and we're moving back up through this help file with the K command. When you're looking at documentation and reading man pages, anytime you see a caret symbol, just know that that means control. The caret symbol looks like a little small upside down V, and some people like to call it a hat. Anyway, caret F is really control F, and it means that you hold down the control key and type the character F. And that's exactly how you move forward one window or how you page down. So I'm going to hold control, type F, and we move down the file one screen. So I'll do that again, control F, and we're down even more. Now to go back or backwards, type control B. So I'll do that twice, and that puts us right where we started. Here is another Vimism, if you will. You can precede a command with a number called a count. That causes the command that follows the number to be repeated that number of times. I think I made that sound way more complicated than it actually is. So a quick example will clear it up. For example, to move down three lines, all you have to do is type 3J. It's that simple. And if you want to move up three lines, type 3K. Next, I want to talk about jumping to the top of the file or top of the man page and jumping to the bottom. And if I hit Control F a couple of times, I come to the jumping section in this bit of documentation, and it says G is the command that we can use to go to the first line in the file, and capital G can go to the last line in the file. So I'm going to hit lowercase g right now, just type G, and we're back at the very beginning of the file. So no matter where you're at, you can just hit G and you're right back at the top. Now, if you want to go to the very end, you can hit Shift G, which is capital G, and you're all the way to the bottom of the man page or whatever it is that you're looking at. So that's how you can jump to the very beginning or very end really quickly. I'm going to hit G to go back to the very top. And by the way, feel free to use the alternatives listed here. For example, you could hit the space bar to move forward one window, and you could hit the Enter key to move down one line. And by the way, CR stands for carriage return, which means simply to type Enter. The point is to just use whatever works for you. Use what you can remember. For me, using the Vim key bindings makes a lot of sense because once you know them, you can use them in pagers, of course, in the Vim editor, in the vi sudo command, and many other places on a Linux system. It might be a little bit of a learning curve, but it really pays off in the long run. So those are the main movements that you'll make, jumping around, moving by line, moving by screen. Now let's quickly cover searching in a man page. If you want to start a forward search, type forward slash followed by the pattern you're searching for. So I'm going to type in forward slash and type in the word display and hit enter. And it jumps to the very next occurrence of display. Now, if I want to repeat this search in the exact same direction, I can just hit lowercase n, which you can think of as standing for next or the next match. So I'll type n, and we go to the next occurrence of this match, which of course is display. If we type n again, what's going to happen is the screen is going to move up by one line, and we're going to be placed at the next occurrence of display. So I'll hit n, and you can see everything just shifted up by one because that is where the next occurrence was. Again, I'm going to hit N and we'll jump all the way down to the next match. Now to reverse the direction that you're searching in, use a capital N or Shift N. So if I type Shift N, that goes to the previous match. Again, Shift N to the previous match and so on. I'm going to type Control B to go back here to show the searching section of this documentation. Here you can see that the question mark followed by a pattern initiates a backward search. So if you want to start where you're at, but look up in the file or up in the man page, you use question mark followed by a pattern. I'm going to demonstrate this by using the search pattern of one, O-N-E, and press enter. So if you want to go to the next match, just type lowercase n. Notice that it's still searching in the same direction. It's searching in reverse, if you will, which means that it's going toward the top of the file. So lowercase n just jumps to the next match in the same direction that the search was started in. So I hit N again, and we're still going up the file and so on. Now, if I want to reverse this and go back the other direction, then I use capital N. So I'll just type Shift N, and I'm going back through the file, skipping back to these previous matches. So that's all you need to know in order to effectively navigate inside a man page. To get out of the help screen, we just type Q, and we're back to the man page. I'm going to move down the man page here with Control F. And I'm going to stop right here. Now let's get into what the various man page conventions mean so we can put what we see in a man page actually into action. Anytime you see bold text in a man page, you are to type it exactly as shown. There's no room for interpretation. Just type exactly what you see if it's in bold text. On the next line, it says if you encounter any italic text, to replace it with an appropriate argument. Now, I want to point out that if you skip down a little bit, you'll see that the exact rendering may vary depending on the output device. For instance, man will usually not be able to render italics when running in a terminal and will typically use underline or colored text instead. So this particular terminal that I'm using is actually doing the underline, and quite honestly, that's probably what you're going to see as well. So anytime you see any underlined text in a man page, that means you need to substitute it with something that's appropriate. The next convention is surrounding things in brackets. So anytime you see anything in brackets, just remember that it's optional, that you don't have to use it. If you come across two options that are separated by the pipe symbol or a vertical bar, just know that they cannot be used together. Now this might make some sense to you if you've done some programming, because a lot of programming languages use the pipe as the OR symbol. So in this example, you can either use dash A or dash B, you just can't use both of those options at the same time. On the next line, we see argument followed by three periods. Some people would say those are three dots. In any case, those three periods or three dots are also called an ellipsis. Anytime you see something that's followed by an ellipsis, that means you can repeat it. And if we go to the last line in this block, it says that the entire expression within the brackets is repeatable. So again, if it's something within brackets and it's followed by an ellipsis, just know you can repeat that multiple times. Now that you know how to navigate through a man page and know what the man page conventions are, let's look at a man page and actually dissect it. So I'm going to type Q to exit this man page. Let's look at the man page for the ls command. So I'll type man space ls and hit enter. The synopsis of the command is ls followed by option. Notice that that's in brackets. And also notice that there is an ellipsis that follows that. And then it has a file, also in brackets, and another ellipsis. This tells us that you can execute the ls command with one or more options and or one or more files. By the way, when you see file in Linux or in a man page, you should really think to yourself file or directory. There's often no distinction between the two when it comes to commands and their documentation. Anyway, let's break this command down. The option is in brackets, which means it's optional. Said another way, an option is not required. You may or may not use an option when you run the ls command. Also, the ellipsis that follows the option in brackets means that you can use multiple options. Again, since options are not required, you may have 0, 1, or even many options. The same is true with file. It's in brackets, which means it isn't required. It's also followed by an ellipsis, which means you can specify more than one file if you wish. One thing you should gather from the synopsis is that you can run this command on its own, since everything is optional. If you continue reading the man page, you'll find out what happens when you don't supply any arguments or options to ls. It says, list information about the files, the current directory by default. So let's try that now. I'll type Q to exit the man page. Let me move into a directory that has a lot of files in it, so I'm going to change into /etc. Now I'm going to execute the ls command without any options or files, so I'll type ls and hit enter. Per the man page, you are now seeing the files that are in the current directory. Let's specify an optional file to ls. Let's say we want to look at the password file. So we'll do ls, and password on Linux systems is actually spelled P-A-S-S-W-D. So that's not very interesting. It just shows what we've already typed in, but at least it works. Let's give ls a directory and see what it does with that. So let's do this directory, lscron.d. That command lists the files inside the cron.d directory, and it appears there is only one file there. Let's give ls multiple files. Again, I'm using the word file loosely here, as I'm really going to use one file and one directory. But remember, whenever you see file in a man page, think file and or directory. So I'm going to type in lspasswd and cron.d and hit enter. So it shows the file password, and then it shows the directory followed by a colon and the contents of that directory, which happened to be just one file, zero hourly. Now let's go back to the man page and see what else we can do with ls. Let's look at some of those optional options that we can use. The first one listed in the man page is -a, --all. Really, this is the exact same option, but in two different formats. The short format is -a, and the long format is --all. You only need to use one of the formats. By the way, I'm using the word dash. I use it interchangeably with hyphen, so if you hear me talking about a hyphen or a dash, I'm talking about the exact same thing here. Anyway, let me find another example of this. So I'm just going to hit Ctrl+F to go down through the man page, and one I spot here is -F, followed by --classify. This, of course, means that you can use either -f or --classify, as they do the exact same thing. This particular option appends a character to a file or directory that indicates what type of file or directory it is. For example, if the file is an executable, it will be marked with an asterisk. If it's a directory, it will end with a /, and so on. So let's see what that does. I'll type Q to get out of the man page, and we're just going to type ls to refresh our memory of what the ls output looks like. And now let's run it with the -F option, ls --F, and hit enter. Now notice that the directories end in /, symlinks end with an @ sign, and so on. Now, if we execute ls with the dash dash classify option, you'll see it's exactly the same thing as running ls dash capital F. So I'll do that now. ls dash dash classify, hit enter, and really nothing on our screen changes because we get the exact same output. Okay, let's get back to the lsman page and keep exploring. Let's look at this option, dash dash block dash size equals size. Notice that dash dash block dash size equal sign is in bold, which means to type it as it is. Now, it might be hard to tell on my terminal, but if you're using a dark background, you'll clearly see that that's in bold, and that should be typed exactly as is. However, notice that the capital word size is underlined. That means we need to replace it with something appropriate. Sometimes when people get to this point, they don't know what is appropriate or what the valid options are, and many times the man page tells you right then and there, but sometimes it refers you to another section of the man page, as in this case. And even some rare cases, it will actually refer you to another man page where you have to look up the valid options. Anyway, here it says, see size format below. So let's do a forward search for size. So I'll just type forward slash size and hit enter. Okay, we already see that. I'm gonna hit N to go to the next match and so on. I'll just keep hitting N here. Okay, this looks like what we're after. It says size is an integer and optional unit. So here it's giving you some examples like 10 capital M, and it says that's 10 times 1024 times 1024. It says the units are KM, GT, PE, ZY, powers of 1024, or KB, MB, which are powers of 1000. Okay, so it's not really important what these sizes are. What's important here is the concept that the man page gives you the valid options, and it gives you examples of what those valid options are. So again, to repeat, we found size, which was underlined, which means we had to find what the valid options to replace it with, and here we found those in the man page. Let's continue with a similar example. I'm going to type G to go back to the beginning of the man page, and I'm going to type Control F to go down to what I'm looking for. Oh, and I see it right there at the bottom of this page. It's dash dash color bracket equals when closing bracket. Here, dash dash color is in bold, so you type it as it is. You can optionally provide an equal sign followed by when. Notice that when is underlined, so that means it needs to be replaced. In this example, it gives you the valid options for when right here. Those valid options are never, auto, or always. Let's try that out. So I'm going to hit Q to quit the man page and type ls dash dash color equals none and hit enter. If you have color enabled like I do, this disables it. And you could read more about colors in, well, you guessed it, the man page. Let's look at another common thing you'll find in man pages. I'm going to skip down to it here. Let's look at the dash h or dash dash human dash readable option. For this option, it needs to be used with dash L. When you see with, for example, that means the option will either do nothing on its own, or it will not be valid on its own, or it will be practically worthless without the other option or options listed. So let's check this out. I'll type Q to get out of the man page, type ls-h. That seems to be practically useless. I don't see any difference in the output. So this time, let's combine it with one of those options it says to use it with. One of those options was dash L. So I'll do ls space dash L space dash H and hit enter. Now we're seeing file sizes displayed in a human readable format. So if we compare it to this ls dash L, in this ls dash L output, the last item here is yum.repos.d and its size is currently listed as 4096. But when we add that ls dash L dash H option and hit enter, this time the size is displayed as 4.0k, which is in a more human-friendly, human-readable format. By the way, when you're working with multiple single-character options, you can combine them. What I mean by that is that you can use one hyphen followed by all the single-character options you want to use. That means we can do this, ls space dash l followed by h. We're just combining all the single-character options into one option in front of this one dash or this one hyphen, and we hit enter and we get that same output. Of course, it's exactly the same as dash L space dash H. This is a Linux convention and it really doesn't have anything directly to do with man pages. However, I want you to know exactly what is happening when you see something like this. For example, when you're searching around trying to figure out how to do something and you see a reference to ls-lh and you can't find a -lh option in the man page, you might wonder what's going on. Well, of course, now you know. But anyway, this type of thing can be really confusing if you don't know that those are actually two separate options, -l and -h, both squeezed together. Also, for most options, the order doesn't matter. That means you can execute the same command in multiple ways and still get the exact same behavior and exact same result. For example, you can do ls space dash h dash l, which is the same as ls dash l dash h, which is also the same as ls dash hl, and is also the same as ls space dash lh. All four of those commands are the exact same command. If you want to use single character options and long form options together, you can still squeeze all the single options together and then also use the longer option. For example, we can use ls space dash sh space dash dash color equals none and hit enter. Remember, most of the time order doesn't matter, and when it does, the man page will tell you so. So you can actually do this as well. We'll do ls space dash dash color equals none space dash hs and hit enter. And that's the exact same command that we ran before, even though it's in a different order. Just for fun, let's throw in another option. Let's do ls dash dash color equals none dash hs and capital F that we used earlier. So now we're combining multiple options all together at once and making ls behave exactly the way you want it to. Let's look at one more thing you'll need to know when reading man pages. Let's jump back into the man page here. Going to search for this particular option called width. Here we have two forms of the same option. One is dash w and the other is dash dash width. Dash dash width is followed by an equal sign and it expects you to supply a column width. What the man page doesn't explain and what it expects you to know already is that when you use the short form of dash w, you also have to specify the number of columns. And you don't use an equal sign in that case either. Let's walk through an example. Type q to get out of the man page. We can do ls space dash dash width equals 60 and hit enter. And that is going to be the same thing as ls space dash w space 60. Notice there is no equal sign there. So we'll hit enter and we'll get the same output. By the way, if you don't supply the columns, you're going to get an error. So we'll do ls space dash w. And this is what it looks like when you have an error. Also be aware that you don't have to supply a space between the option and its argument. So we could do this ls space dash w without a space 60 and hit enter. And that is valid syntax. So let me ask you a question. How would you handle using multiple one character options with one that expects an argument? Well, you just put the option that requires an argument last and provide the value of that argument. If you wanted to use the dash capital F option with the dash W option at the same time, you could do this. We could do ls space dash capital F. And the last option that we're going to use is dash W because it requires an argument to it. And then we'll supply that argument, which we've been using 60 and hit enter. We can also use that space in there. We can use ls space dash f w space 60 and hit enter. That's also valid syntax. If you were to try to supply another option right after w, it would take that as being its argument. And this isn't going to work. So we can do this ls dash w capital F and put 60 for our width. But ls isn't really going to understand that dash capital F is another option, while 60 is really what we wanted to be an argument to the dash W option. So let's hit enter and see what we get here. So it says F60 is an invalid line width because it thinks F60 is its argument. The overwhelming majority of time, you won't need to think about or worry about man page sections, which is what we're going to cover next. But because they're an important part of the man system, and in some rare cases, you might need to use it or you might see it, I want to cover it really quickly. So let's go in the man page for man and look at the sections here. Many of the commands you look up will be in section 1. If you're working with system administration commands, you'll most likely be reading man pages from section 8. If you happen to be doing some low-level Linux programming, you might find yourself looking at some man pages in sections 2 and 3, for example. You can tell what section you're currently in by looking at the top left of the man page. So I'm going to go to the very top of this man page by typing G, and the number you see in parentheses is the section number. So the man page for the man command itself is in section 1. Really, most of the time, you're not going to pay attention to what section you're in, nor do you probably need to even care. There's really only one time when this matters, and that's when there are man pages for one thing in multiple sections. By default, man uses a predefined order to search through man pages, and it just gives you the first one it finds. And this is fine most of the time. Let's look at a couple of examples. To search through man pages, use man-k followed by one or more terms. Of course, the -k option and how to use it is in the man page for the man command. So I'm going to look for unlink. Yep. There is a man page for unlink in section 1, 1p, 2, and 3p. If we just run man unlink, we end up looking at the man page in section 1. So let's try that out now. Man unlink, hit enter. Sure enough, the number in parentheses is 1, and so we're looking at the man page for unlink in section 1. So let's quit out of here with Q. However, if you want to see the man page from another section, specify that section. So we'll do man space 2, unlink, hit enter, and now you can see 2 is in parentheses, and we're looking at the man page for unlink in section 2. By the way, this is the man page you want if you're doing low-level programming and making system calls. Again, for most people, we're just using commands on the system and we really don't care about this. But if you ever need this information, you'll know exactly how to get to this man page. Type Q, and let's look at the other one here. We'll do man 3p unlink and hit enter. The sections that end in p are part of the POSIX documentation. POSIX stands for Portable Operating System Interface, and it's a set of standards used by Unix and Unix-like operating systems. As it says in the man page here, the Linux implementation may be different. So you want to know how to look up the Linux-specific documentation, and that's by looking in the Linux sections, which are those sections that do not end in a P. Let's look at another example. Let's look for ARP, man-k, A-R-P, and hit enter. Let's see what section we get when we man ARP. Type man ARP, hit enter. Okay, we're in section 8, and we know that because that is what's in parentheses at the top left of our screen. And if you recall from the man page, section 8 is for system administration commands. Let's look at section 7. Type Q here, type man 7 ARP, hit enter, and now we're looking at section 7. So this looks like information for programmers about ARP, and that's totally awesome. I probably will never need this man page in particular. I personally just need the man page in section 8 to teach me how to use the ARP command itself. So that's all you'll ever need or care to know about man page sections. Now let's look at the man page that outlines the conventions used in writing man pages. Let me find that real quick. I'll type Q to get out of that man page. Do a search for man pages and see what comes up. Okay, what I'm looking for is man-pages. This document actually teaches you how to write man pages. You may never write a man page in your life, but you can use this document to learn more about man pages. For example, let's look at the sections that are commonly found within a man page. So I'll do a forward search here for sections within, and we get a list of sections here. Man pages may include some or all of these headings. You'll at least find the name, the synopsis, the description, and a see also element for each man page. If you keep reading this man page, you'll find out exactly what should be included in each of those sections. This comes in really handy. For example, if you want to know what options are available for a command, go straight to the options section of the man page. If you're writing shell scripts and you want to check the exit status of a command, you can find what exit status the command supports by looking in the exit status section of the man page. If there are any environment variables that affect the behavior of the program, you'll find those in the environment section. Any files that are associated with the command are found in the file section. For example, if you want to know what configuration files control a given program, read the Files section of the man page. Some man pages provide examples and common use cases, and of course, those are found in the Examples section. Finally, the See Also section lists related man pages. This can be helpful when you're not exactly sure what command you're looking for. If you end up on a related command's man page, you can often find the actual command you're looking for in the See Also section. Man pages are really awesome, but there are some commands that don't have a dedicated man page. Mainly, these commands are shell built-ins. Shell built-ins are literally built into the shell. You can think of them as internal commands. When you type a built-in command on the command line and press enter, the shell executes that internal command. Because it's contained within the shell itself, the shell never has to read a separate file on disk and execute that separate file. Since it's not a separate program, that program doesn't have its own man page. You can find information for shell built-ins by looking at the shell man page. The most commonly used shell on Linux systems is Bash, so let's look at the man page for Bash. I'm going to do a forward search here for the shell built-in commands, and we'll see sections here that are referencing that section. Keep moving down here, I'm hitting N. And here's that section that lists all the shell built-in commands. The first shell built-in I want to show you is the help command, so I'm going to do a forward search for help. The help built-in displays help for a given built-in command. So if a command is a shell built-in and it doesn't have its own man page, you can read its documentation by typing help followed by that command. Help is like the shell's own mini-man system, if you will. We'll use this in just a minute. Now the next shell built-in I want to show you is the type command, /type, and hit enter. The type command tells you what type of command something is. This is how you can tell if something is a shell built-in or an executable file. So let's try this out. I'll hit Q, just type in help, and hit enter. The help command without any arguments displays the commands it can give you help on. Let's get some help on the help command itself. So we'll type help. Help and hit enter. So that's really the whole idea behind the help command. Now let's try out the type command. So we'll type type followed by help, and type tells us that help is a shell built-in. And that brings us full circle. Let's say you're writing some shell scripts and you want to know the syntax of the while command. First, you try to read the man page for while. It turns out there's not a man page for the while command. But you're absolutely certain that while is a valid command because you've used it before in your shell scripts. It's just that right now you can't remember the exact syntax and you need a little help. Let's see what type has to say about it. Type reports that while is a shell keyword, which is a type of shell built-in. Let's see if we can get its documentation with a help built-in command. So we'll do help, followed by while, and hit enter. And sure enough, we get a brief help on the while command. Here's what happens when we man fg, which is the command that brings a process running in the background into the foreground. So we'll type man fg and hit enter. What happens is we get the man page for bash. This tells me right away that fg is a shell built-in command, and we can confirm that. We can do that with type fg. Sure enough, it's a shell built-in. And of course, you know how to get help on built-ins by using help followed by the shell built-in command. So that's how you can get access to the manuals and documentation for shell built-ins. By the way, many commands have built-in help that they'll display for you. Most commonly, commands accept the --help option, and less commonly, commands accept the --h or even --?? Options. Let's try it out on the man command. So man space --help and hit enter. Sure enough, it supports that and it dumps out its help. Let's do that with the ls command, ls space --help. Sure enough, we get some help on the ls command. Let's try out my favorite editor, Vim. Vim --help. Sure enough, we get a list of options that Vim supports. And as you can see at the bottom, Vim also supports the shorter --h option. So if we run Vim space --h, we can get help that way. That was a lot of information, and if you're still with me, you have all the information you will ever need about man pages and getting help on a Linux system. So that we can get this information to stick with you, let's do a quick review of what you've learned. First off, MAN is the built-in help system in Linux. MAN is short for manual, and a MAN page is simply the documentation for a given program or command. You can use the MAN command to read MAN pages. To get help with the MAN command itself, run MAN MAN. From there, you can get additional help by typing the letter H. To quit or exit out of a MAN page, type Q. The MAN command uses less to display MAN pages. This allows you to navigate within a MAN page using Vim key bindings. You can move down a line by typing J, move up a line by typing K, move forward a screen by typing Ctrl F, and move backwards a screen by typing Ctrl B. To go to the very beginning of the MAN page, type lowercase g, and to go to the very end, type capital G. Next, you learn the conventions that are used in MAN pages. For example, you learn that when you see bold text in a MAN page, you're supposed to type it exactly as seen. For italic or underlined text, you need to substitute it with something appropriate. You also learn that anytime you see something in brackets, it's optional. If a pair of options are separated by a pipe symbol, they can only be used one at a time and not together. You also learn that anything that appears directly before an ellipsis can be repeated. From there, we talked about how to combine single character options using one hyphen. For example, the shortened version of ls space dash l space dash h is ls space dash lh, and both commands are exactly the same in behavior. For some options, you can use a short format or a long format. In the MAN page, these options are separated by a comma, which means that you can use either form you wish. When a long format of an option requires an argument, the short format does too, even if it's not explicitly stated in the MAN page. For example, ls space dash dash width equals 60 is the same as ls space dash w space 60. Also, you can remove the space between the single character option and its argument, so ls space dash w60 is valid syntax as well. You learned about the various MAN page sections and how to tell MAN to use a specific section for a given MAN page. The format is MAN followed by the section followed by the MAN page. For example, to see the MAN page for unlink in section 2, you would execute MAN 2 unlink. You can search through MAN pages using the dash K option to the MAN command. MAN will display the sections in parentheses for each of the matching MAN pages. This is how you can tell if there is more than one MAN page for a given command. We also talked about bash built-in commands and how many times they don't have their own dedicated MAN pages. To see the documentation for these internal shell commands, use the help command. To determine if a command is an executable file on a system or if it's a shell built-in, use the type command. Finally, we talked about how many commands will display a help message if you supply the dash dash help argument to the command. Some commands will also respond to dash h. Well, you've made it to the end, and I sincerely hope that you found this video helpful. By the way, if you want a copy of my own notes, visit linuxtrainingacademy.com/man, that's /MAN, and you can get a copy of all my notes that I used to create this presentation. So if you need a cheat sheet or a reminder, go ahead and go there now. Also, if you've enjoyed this video, I'm sure you would love my courses, where I not only teach and demonstrate like I've done here today, but I also give you practice exercises and labs so that you can use what you've learned in the real world. So head on over to linuxtrainingacademy.com, where you'll find a variety of self-paced Linux courses as well as instructor-led courses. All these courses are all online, available anytime that you're ready. I hope to see you there.